In this video, we are going to look at input-output, or how we can interface peripherals to a CPU. So first, let's try and understand the context of a CPU in an overall system. The CPU by itself consists of the basic components we have looked at so far. Basically, the ALU, that is the arithmetic and logic unit, the register file, and a few other components. An interface to memory, which in this case I have shown as being inside the CPU, but in general could be outside the CPU proper itself. And of course, we have control. The control logic in this case generates all the read enable, write enable signals, and so on. But a CPU like this cannot do very much. All it can do is perform computations based on data that is already present in memory, and the outputs of that same computation will also only be able to go back into the memory. How do we extend this? In fact, in general, we know that when we use a computer, we have many other interaction devices that are connected to it. The keyboard and mouse are used for providing inputs to the computer. A video display is used in order to see the output. Disks are used in order to store data. Ethernet or Wi-Fi or similar kinds of network connections are used in order to communicate with the outside world. Now, this is true irrespective of whether we are talking about a desktop computer, or an iPhone, or an iPad, or even just a microcontroller. All of them have different kinds of user interface devices, but apart from that, they also have some means of communicating with the outside world. The question is, in general, how do we get the CPU to talk to other devices outside of what it has already got built into it? So a typical, or rather an obvious way of connecting the CPU to peripherals would be to say, okay, fine, I have a CPU. Let me consider that as the center of my universe and create dedicated links to each of the peripherals that I want to connect. So for example, if I know that I want to build a computer with a keyboard and mouse, my CPU itself will be designed in such a way that it has a specific port, a specific set of wires, whose job is only to talk to the keyboard and mouse. Similarly, I'll have another set of wires that go to the video display, other sets of wires that go to the disks, and to the network, and so on. The CPU itself can be expanded by having custom instructions that allow it to read and write into each of these peripherals. The attachments are basically called peripherals. How many peripherals can be connected to the CPU? And if you want to connect a new peripheral to the CPU, do you need to redesign the entire CPU from scratch? All of these are relevant questions when we come up with this kind of topology for attaching peripherals to the CPU. What about a multi-CPU system? In this case, we have multiple masters, and we might want to establish point-to-point connections between each of those masters and the corresponding peripherals. So for example, if I have a dual CPU system, in principle, I might want the keyboard input to go to either one of them. So how should I connect it? Do I have point-to-point links between each of the CPUs and the keyboard and mouse? You can see that this doesn't really scale. We would definitely run into trouble as we start increasing the number of peripherals. On top of that, the peripheral itself needs to have knowledge of how many masters are connected to it, and it needs to decode which of the masters is trying to talk to it at present and how it should respond. This essentially sort of helps us to identify the main problems when we are trying to interface external devices to a CPU. Scalability is one of our biggest issues. As we saw in the previous picture, increasing the number of links scales as the product of the number of masters, CPUs, and the number of peripherals. We also have a problem with heterogeneity. Not all peripherals have the same speed or bandwidth requirements. For example, keyboards and mice are used for inputs from the person, and typically we cannot type more than, let's say, about 10 keystrokes a second, which is itself very high. Even if we press all the keys down at the same time, you are not going to get something higher than that. Now, 10 keystrokes a second is one every 100 milliseconds or so, whereas the CPU is working on a totally different speed scale. It's working in the hundreds of megahertz or possibly even gigahertz frequency ranges. On the other hand, peripherals such as the Ethernet controller or the video links require much higher bandwidths. There's a lot of data that needs to be transferred in order to keep the video going at a fixed rate. And similarly, Ethernet is used in order to transfer data at fairly high speeds. So you can see that the speed requirements of the different peripherals, such as the keyboard versus Ethernet, would be quite different. The next question that comes up is, how do we add a new peripheral? Do we need to redesign the CPU every time we want to attach a new peripheral? What if somebody created a new kind of mouse or maybe a joystick or a touchscreen? Does it mean that the CPU itself needs to be redesigned if we want to attach a new peripheral of this sort? Clearly, that's also not really a good solution. In order to look at an answer to all of this, let's try and understand what exactly happens when we try to read from a memory location. The CPU, for example, using the load instruction, would first generate an address, either using the ALU or some supporting circuitry. And the control logic would also be responsible for generating a read signal. That address, as well as the read signal, would be sent to a peripheral, which I have put memory with a question mark on it, purposely to indicate that this is a memory-like peripheral, meaning that it takes an address and it takes a read-enabled signal and it returns data. But is there any way to really guarantee that this is actually a storage? In other words, is this memory peripheral actually giving us data corresponding to some physical memory location? Or is it just returning data that it feels we need corresponding to whatever address we have asked? Understanding this allows us to replace the entire memory block with something else that behaves in a similar fashion, in the sense that it will return data when asked for it, but the data that it returns can now be programmed, can be changed depending on what kind of behavior we want. As an example, let's look at a simple counter. And the scenario that we are looking at over here is one where we would have a simple CPU. We would take its address bus and the read-enable signal and essentially ignore them. And what we would do is take the counter, which gives back a 32-bit value, and just connect this as the data being read back into the processor. Now, if you look at this, what is happening over here is, irrespective of which instruction or which address we are trying to load data from, as long as we perform a load instruction inside the CPU, the data that will come back will always be the data coming from the counter. In other words, the actual address and the read enable are ignored. And the data that comes back is just whatever data was present inside the counter. Now, obviously, this is not a good idea because it means that we can't use the data memory at all. We do not have a data memory in this case. But it is actually an interesting concept in the sense that this allows us to perform reads from a peripheral, and the data coming back from the peripheral is just something which is computed by the peripheral itself. You'll notice that the dout itself is an assigned statement, meaning that we have a combinational logic to return the value. But the value internally is updated once every clock cycle by incrementing in an internal register. We could further complicate this by also taking into account the read-enable signal. Now, what this does is, only if the read-enable signal is high will rint be incremented. This is an interesting kind of peripheral. Effectively, the value that it returns at any given point in time will be the number of read requests or the number of load instructions that have executed inside the processor. Is it useful? Probably not, because we have essentially taken away any concept of having any other memory. So we can't really do much with the data that we have. All that we can do is read from this peripheral. Now, this idea that, you know, we ignore the data address is not clearly a good solution. But if we look closer at how the memory itself is laid out, we can think in terms of a memory map. The key point over here is all of the memory is not a single storage unit, and it is possible to have multiple memory blocks that are located in different areas of the memory. The figure on the right essentially shows what corresponds to a 16-bit address space. And the reason it's 16 bits is because the address that I've shown just to the left of the figure varies from 0000, which is a 16-bit zero value, to FFFF, which is 16 bits of ones. You could have a larger address space. This is just for illustration. Now, The MEM1, MEM2, and MEM3 have generally been shown as blocks within this overall figure. And the reason is, the claim over here is that somehow I'm going to have logic which says that if I try to access something in the region corresponding to MEM1, that is an address 0000 up to some small value, let's say 0100 or something like that, all of those addresses will actually respond and the data there will come back from memory location, memory block number MEM1. After that, MEM2 is located in a totally different area of the memory. This probably corresponds to, let's say, 0400 and goes up to something like 0500. And the last block could correspond to something like F000 all the way up to FFFF. Keep in mind that even though I say 0500 over here, what I actually mean is that 0500 is the next address beyond the edge, and this last location over here is actually going to be 04FF. Similarly, 0100 corresponds to the next location beyond the boundary of MEM1, and the last location here would actually be 00FF. These are just example numbers. The point is that you could assign any range of memory locations to any memory block. The rest of the memory locations essentially mean there is no hardware connected. What happens if you try reading from, let's say, address location number 0200? It's not defined. The CPU has no obligation to give you valid data. In fact, the CPU does not even have a way of knowing whether or not there is hardware connected over there in general. You could have other techniques by which the CPU could detect whether or not hardware is actually connected at certain locations, but at the very core implementation of the CPU, this is not required. All that it says is, if you try to read from an unknown location, the behavior is undefined. You cannot be guaranteed of any kind of specific result coming back. And of course, the important thing to observe over here is how each of these memory blocks generates the data that it returns is not really relevant. What that means is, we could, for example, assign peripherals instead of memory one. So one way of doing it would be, we take the first 256 bytes from peripheral that we call A. So peripheral A is down here and essentially consists of address location 0000 to 00FF. And peripheral 2 corresponds to peripheral B, and it has the next 256 memory locations. What this means is that any of the addresses from 00 up to 00FF will be responded to by peripheral 1, that is A. And address locations from 0100 to 01FF will get responses from peripheral 2, that is B. In this case, of course, I have chosen non-overlapping ranges. In general, you need to have non-overlapping ranges because otherwise you run into other problems with contention. There is rarely any benefit from having overlapping memory ranges. In some cases, you might find that it's useful. For example, you can read the same memory location from different peripherals, for example. But in general, it only causes confusion. And the way that we implement this in general is not going to accept multiple peripherals trying to read or write the same memory location. The question, of course, becomes, who decodes this address? Who decides which memory block is supposed to respond? In the previous example, we said that addresses in the range 00 up to FF would be responded to by peripheral A. Does peripheral A need to know that? Or could peripheral A have been designed in such a way that it just knows it has a 256 byte block of addresses to which it needs to respond? If we decide that peripheral A does not need to know that it is actually at memory locations 00 up to FF, then one way of doing it could be that the CPU itself assigns the fact that address location 00 to FF are corresponding to peripheral A. And in which case, it would need to activate control signals specific to peripheral A when the address is in the range 00 to FF. It will also have to turn off all the other blocks, prevent changes in the data bus, and so on. While this is doable, it's not clear how well it scales. How do we add more peripherals? How do we bake the information into the CPU that peripheral A is located at this memory block? The peripheral itself, if it needs to know which address range it has been assigned, then that introduces another set of problems. Basically, what if I had one peripheral which was designed for a CPU which is in range 00 to FF, and somebody else designs another peripheral which also thinks it needs to be in the same range? How can I assign both of these to the same CPU? I can't build a system that incorporates both peripherals. As a result, the usual technique that is followed is to use a separate arbiter. The arbiter is a separate piece of logic whose job is to arbitrate, or essentially play the judge between the CPU and peripherals. Whenever the CPU tries to access a given peripheral, the arbitrator or the arbiter decides whether or not it is allowed to access it, whether the peripheral is free, and if so, it routes the information from the CPU to the corresponding peripheral. This means that the arbiter can now take care of the partial decoding of addresses. In particular, what it will do is it will look at the top 8 bits of the address. If it matches 00, it means that the CPU is trying to talk to peripheral A. Now, this information needs to be present inside the arbiter, but that could be in some kind of a lookup table. The CPU by itself does not need to be redesigned. Only the arbiter needs to have this information baked into it. And creating an arbiter that can have different addresses for different peripherals is a much more restricted task and easier to solve than trying to redesign a CPU itself. Now, you'll notice that the arbiter is only looking at the top 8 bits of the address. The remaining 8 bits, marked as XX over here, will be passed straight into peripheral A, which will then respond accordingly. The arbiter also has to do the reverse task, which is it takes the inputs from each of the peripherals, A and B, and takes care that if the CPU was trying to talk to A, only the response from A goes back to the CPU, and whatever comes from B is basically shut out or ignored. Coming back to the example of the read counter, if we want to map the address 0400 to the read counter, what we can do is any read access to this address will return a value from this counter. So the read counter clearly does not have 256 memory locations. It has only one register value that it's returning. But it does not really matter. Most of the time, what we would do is we would just allocate a large block of memory, or maybe multiple addresses, to any given peripheral. In this case, if I take the specific example that I'm going to map the address 0400 to a read counter, what would happen is every time I try to read from this memory location, I would get back the value that would come from the read counter. Any other address, on the other hand, would respond according to the memory map. If it corresponded to a memory block, the data would come from the memory. If it corresponded to some other peripheral, it would come from that peripheral, and so on. This means that the counter module is always present, but effectively it responds only when activated, and the activation itself is taken care of by this arbiter block. What happens if I need to change the system, maybe change the address at which it is mapped? I just need to make some changes in the arbiter code or in the lookup table corresponding to the arbiter. As long as the normal word alignment requirements are followed, we would not have any problems with memory alignment or reading from any arbitrary memory location. And pretty much any address can be chosen that does not clash with some other peripheral that is already present in the system. What about writing to memory, or in turn writing to peripherals? Similar to the case of reading, we would use the store instructions as opposed to load. And what happens in the case of writing is that the address would be generated in the ALU. The data to be written would be placed onto the DW data bus, and a write signal would have to be generated by the control logic. What about the peripheral? It needs to accept this address, which, as seen before, would probably be controlled by the arbiter to decide whether or not the peripheral needs to respond. But once the peripheral has been activated, it needs to accept the data. What exactly does this mean? In particular, let's say that I perform a write to a given address, and then I try doing a read from that address. is there any necessity that I should get back the same data when I try to read it? If you think about it, the answer is no. I could perfectly well create a system where the data that I write to a given memory location could be quite different from the data that comes back when I try reading from the same memory location. There is nothing fundamental about the way that the system is implemented, at least, that enforces the same data to come back. This means, for example, that I could even think of something like a write-only peripheral. In this case, I'm essentially creating something which would allow us to turn on or off LEDs. If you look at it, the way that the peripheral itself works is very simple. All that it does is whenever the write-enable signal is high, the internal register rint will get the value being written in from dIn. And this value is combinationally assigned to an output, that is the LED output. What we could do is, if we were putting this together on a breadboard or on some kind of hardware, we could actually take 32 LEDs, connect them up to these wires, and whatever value is written as a result of the store instruction would turn on or off different LEDs in this. You'll notice that this peripheral is a write-only peripheral. It does not return any values at all, which means that if I tried to connect this to address location, let's say 0400, and then I tried to perform a read or a load instruction from address location 0400, I essentially do not know what will return because the wires are simply not connected. There is no guarantee that it will be zero or any other useful value at all. I could take this further and make it a read-write kind of a peripheral. In this case, what we say is, yes, I could write the value in. Whenever the write enable is there, I would write the value in here. And if I try to read, I would get the value in rint itself. Since we cannot have read and write in the same clock cycle, this should work out fine, because what happens is on a given clock edge, the value of dn would get written into rint, and on the very next cycle, if I try to do a load instruction, I would get that same value of rint coming back into dout. So in other words, this effectively implements a one memory location storage. That seems interesting, but we can take this further. There's nothing forcing us to store the value of dn alone into the register. In particular, we could do some computation on it before we store it, or alternatively, we could also have done some computation on dout before sending it back to the CPU. So for example, if I wanted to build a custom piece of hardware whose job is only to square numbers, this is what it could look like. I essentially write a value into this peripheral. The value that gets stored into the peripheral is the square of the value that I write in. And if I then read back from the same address, the result that I'll get will be the square of whatever I wrote in. You can see that this could easily be extended in many different ways. There's nothing fundamentally preventing us from just doing any kinds of operations that we want to in this way. Of course, what we have seen so far is something that always finishes within a single clock cycle. The question becomes, how do we extend beyond that? And we will look at that later. So to summarize, the memory map is a very powerful way to abstract the internal interaction, or rather external interaction, that a CPU needs to have in order to perform its duties. By separating out the job of activating the peripherals and selecting the outputs into a unit called an arbiter, the CPU itself can be designed to have a very clean interface. It just has the address and data buses, and it can essentially talk only to the arbiter. The arbiter in turn takes care of talking to each individual peripheral. Similarly, as far as the peripherals are concerned, they only need to worry about responding to the arbiter. The interesting thing here is this can even scale to multiple masters, where the arbiter can now take care of deciding which of these multiple masters is allowed to access a given peripheral at any given point in time. And in general, this leads to the idea of having complicated bus structures, which can be used to create large systems on chip.